Okay. When you're a car guy or girl, what happens when you date someone who isn't? Today, we'll be talking about life with cars and significant others, instances where that's been a factor, and in general, how lucky we are that our fiancés didn't leave us for someone who isn't as financially irresponsible as us. Welcome to Drive Theory.
Wait. Together. 3, 2, 1. Welcome to Drive Theory.
We also talk about hybrids and current events. Back on the train.
Welcome back to Car Time with Antonio and Isaac.
Welcome back. We are now in the hybrid era of sports cars, and I want to talk to you about that. So this year we had the Corvette E-Ray come out. That's the very first Corvette that's all-wheel drive and it's hybrid. We also have the Lamborghini Revuelto. Revuelto. Okay, and that's the replacement for the Aventador, right?
Correct.
Okay, so that one is also hybrid and all-wheel drive. And the cool thing about the E-Ray and the Revuelto is that it's hybrid and it's a hybrid combination with a naturally aspirated engine. And there's only besides a Prius and a RAV4, there's only a few other examples of that. Like the Porsche 918 Spyder is one. Ugh.
Well, I'll give the drive one of those.
Yeah, I know, right? I can't really think of a whole lot of other ones. But the fact remains, though, is that we are, hybrids have been in use from Formula One for a long. How long have they been in use?
2014 is the first year that they switched to the hybrid V6s.
Okay, yeah. So we're 9 years in with Formula One for hybrids. So we're now starting to see that, as with everything in F1, trickle down into mass production.
Oh, absolutely.
So I think that's kind of a neat thing. But there are some questions with that, because anytime you change something as iconic as a Corvette, or anytime Lamborghini comes out with a new model to replace their outgoing one and it's different with something like, I don't know, a transverse transmission for starters, that's pretty crazy. That kind of stuff begs the question of we know where they come from. We know where the tech is going. And also it's just what's the context of that and why is that significant? So, Tony, you drove a hybrid sports car this past week.
Yeah. Speaking of Formula One tech, because Mercedes likes to talk all about its Formula One tech as it trickles down to the production cars. We're talking the hot V turbo setups, and now we're talking about the hybrid system, the turbocharged engines. The AMG One was basically a proof of concept, their hypercar, and is now the fastest car around the Nürburgring, where it uses the same hybrid V6 powertrain from the Formula One car in a road-going, road-legal car that one could conceivably buy. It's not really, you can't really buy it now, obviously, and there weren't very many of them, but you couldn't buy a Formula One car. You just simply couldn't. So that was that's a big thing. And now that same technology is finding its way into the production cars for Mercedes-Benz. So I drove a Mercedes-Benz AMG C43, which traditionally, the C43's name was first brought out about 20 years ago in the form of a, I believe the C43 had a 4.3 liter V8 in it. And now in the W205 generation, which is just this past previous generation, it had a twin turbo, or a bi-turbo as the Germans like to call it, V6. Meaning that it traditionally has one turbo on either bank of cylinders. And it was like that for the C450s in 2015, and which turned into the C43. And then in 2023 now, which is the first year model of the W206 C43, It is a hybrid four-cylinder, which has come with a lot of controversy. The C63 is also going to get a similar setup, but much different, because the C63 is going to be a plug-in hybrid. The C43 is what's known as a mild hybrid, so there's no plugging in. It just recuperates its energy through braking and coasting and all that good stuff. And the important thing about it, the Formula One tech that they talk about, is using that hybrid. It's really just a starter generator. It's between the engine and the transmission. It starts the engine. It's also the alternator for a car. There's no standalone alternator. And instead of waiting for exhaust pressure to spin the turbine and create boost, it uses, it's like an 8mm wide electric motor inside of the turbo. Spins the turbo prematurely. I have no idea what it would spool at otherwise, but it's a big turbo too. And for this, it's just a 2-liter four cylinder. And with that system, it spools it early, and it gives you a ton of torque down low. And driving it, you can really see where the difference is in power all across the rev range. So the V6 twin turbo in the 205 C43 was rated at 386 horsepower, 382 or 386. And that's peak power. Which is good power for a AMG light like that, and they're all wheel drive, which is great. And the new C43 is rated at 402 horsepower, but the important
what out of a four cylinder
out of a four cylinder, yeah, absolutely, which is nuts because it's the engine out of the CLA-45 and the GLA-45 and the A45. It's that engine just hybridized. And the peak power isn't that much higher than what we've had here in the United States. It was rated for a little bit more in Europe. But what's important is the area under the curve. So under the power curve, because you know you got your power curve, the whole thing is raised. The low end torque is way higher than if you would compare it to a non-hybridized version of this engine. And so you have power all across the rev range. It almost feels naturally aspirated. It almost feels like an LS, like a naturally aspirated V8, the way that delivers that power. It's instantaneous and the throttle response is great. And you don't feel like you're in an electric car, obviously, but you also don't feel like you're in a turbocharged four cylinder unless you're like listening to it, because it sounds like one. So it's one of my favorite AMGs I've ever driven. And I know this isn't a real AMG, except it is, because it's a hand-built engine in that thing. Because the C43 traditionally also did not have a hand-built engine in the 205. In the 206, it does. It's complete with the signature and everything. One guy built it in a Falterbach.
Gesundheit.
And that was one of the things that people would complain about buying an AMG light, you know, an E53 or a C43 or a GLA-35 or something like that. It's just like, it's not a real AMG because, and then of course you have your laundry list of things. It's not a real AMG because it's not a V8, whatever. Not every AMG in history has had a V8. It's not an AMG because it doesn't have a hand-built engine. Well, now it does. And honestly, not just because of the engine, I think it's very deserving of the name. Awesome car. One of my favorite cars that I've ever driven by Mercedes because of how stupid nimble it is. The chassis is great, but the rear axle steers now. And it's the lightest car that Mercedes makes with the rear axle steering. Now, rear axle steering isn't super new or anything.
First time I heard of rear axle steering was the 300 ZX. But I think that's the opposite of what you got, what C43 is, right? Because when the front wheel turns that way, the rear wheels also turn that way.
Yeah, I believe the 300 ZX had that passive rear axle steering. Yeah, where it wasn't hydraulic. It wasn't like Nissan's Atezza system that they use in the Skyline.
Right. It was closer to Prelude, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, no, I think the Prelude also had active steering.
Oh, I got you.
I don't quite remember, though.
But anyways,
I don't know much about Han, like Preludes in general. I know I wanted one for a while, but I don't know any. I don't know much about the 4WS, so I don't know if that's an active steering system. But like, it wasn't. It's not new, and it was. There's a reason. It was extremely expensive to develop and maintain, and of course, they would break. So they didn't really stick around all that much, and then. Now they're back. Porsche uses it. Everybody uses it. No, not everybody, but it's a great system. But the fact that it's in this, this is a very attainable car. It's a $60,000 car. That's not a cheap car, but for what you get. And I would not say this about every Mercedes-Benz on the market, not even close, but for what you get, this is a lot of car for the money. I liked the 205 C43. I love the 206. The steering is ridiculously responsive. That the engine, it's a good sounding four cylinder. And I didn't know how I would feel about going from the V6 to the 4. But after taking it out for a couple of drives and romping on it and really getting to know it, I would almost consider this over a 205 V8. Over a C63, just because of how livable, how nice it is, how nimble it is. I would take this on a back road and tear it up in an instant. It's just that good to drive.
Yeah. That's awesome, man. That's so cool. That's so cool to hear, because it's like, we were just in the last episode, we were just talking about what makes a car exciting and stuff like that. And the fact that you can get a brand new car that is a hybrid, that is a brand new system in a car, and it is as engaging or more than the previous stuff with the bigger engine.
And that's it's everything against what a purist car enthusiast would want. It's got four doors and four seats and plenty of room for five people. It's brand new and uses completely new technology. It's got an iPad here. It's got an iPad here for the infotainment of the dash. You know, it's got stupid ambient lighting that I'm a dumb brain dead sucker for, because I love being bathed in light at night. You know, it has fancy rear wheel steering. It has a low displacement four cylinder that doesn't rev that high, and isn't as maybe characterful as you know, something from an EG, just an old four cylinder. You know, and it has a mild hybrid system. It's just very techy and new, but honestly, I mean, that's for a car that's built by a current state German manufacturer, is very much that isn't Porsche. It is very much a driver's car. I really, really enjoy that vehicle.
So one thing that I have said to you a lot of times that has kind of turned me into, not all the way, not as much as you, but like a little bit of a Mercedes convert, is just the fact that every single Mercedes model that there is an AMG version of.
I know. It's the best thing. It's the best thing that Mercedes does. You can buy a performance version of every single car.
Well, the cooler thing about that is that the C43 proves that it's not just a RS package badged onto the car. That is like an actual, like, The specs that you just described for the new C43 is like, that's like proper sports car, man. I mean, like, it's our sports sedan, which we're going to do a whole episode on sports sedans. We might do two episodes on sports sedan. Every episode might be about sports sedans, but the
C43. Boys, I think sleeper sports sedans are the way to go, and not just sleeper in the sense that it will pass you in a straight line. I'm talking about a sleeper that will kick your ass on a back road too. Cause right. I have a buddy who put it best. He's as far as sleeper sedans goes, and he goes, it hurts more when the second set of doors passes you.
Hey, what's going on?
I haven't heard that before. Okay.
And I would love one of my favorite commercials I've ever seen by Mercedes-Benz, and I cannot for the life of me figure out where I saw it, and I can't find it. Like, I've looked this up in many different ways, in many different configurations, but I know it exists because I'm not funny enough to come up with this on my own. But it was a 205C300 commercial, just a C300. And so they have, you know, you have the Mercedes guys talking in the background, talking about how great it is. And at the very end of the, at the very end of the commercial, he goes, let's say it was your 2020 model year. He goes, the 2020 Mercedes-Benz C300. It's literally the Mercedes of sports sedans.
But I mean, it's, we're diving off into another Mercedes tangent, but like Mercedes, yes, really kind of did, other than Alfa Romeo, of course, in like the 50s and 60s, but like they really did, the Germans really did perfect the sports sedan. And like, it's so cool to see that continue to be innovated and expounded upon now with the C43. And
so, I completely agree. No one does it like the Germans. Yeah. I would take a Mercedes or a BMW sports sedan any day over a Lexus. And I'm still a huge Toyota fanboy. I used to really want an ISF. That used to be like my summit car. I'm like, I don't care if it's the year 2025 and I could have a 10 year newer car. Like a 2013 ISF is like my dream. And I feel a little bit differently about that now, mostly because those cars have continued to go up in value right now. I looked and now I think that Germans do it better than anybody else after driving what I've driven. Or, you know, or I could get a Chevy SS and just call it a day and get, you know, the best in terms of power and gusto and, yeah, naturally aspirated. Well, I mean, the ISF was naturally aspirated as well.
Yeah, for sure. But I was talking about like the Magna Ride that GM has. Oh,
I see. Yeah, those are great cars. I wouldn't mind one of those.
GM has really put out some good suspension engineering in the past like 8 or so years, 9 years. I mean, you know, 20 years more like it. But like in the past 8 or 9 years, GM has really kind of stepped it up. It's certainly not at like a Porsche level, because Porsche has been able to make a back engine car the best car in the world for a very long time. So I'm not trying to say that like GM is the best or anything, but they've certainly, they're better than they have any right to be right now, for sure. But the earlier you mentioned this kind of the C43 is everything a purist would not be into, because, you know, it's like, you know, you get these iPads and stuff like that. So I want to cover one or two more things, one of them being specifically car purist news, before we kind of move on to our like big topic of the day. Gordon Murray signed off on the GMA T50 this week.
Oh yeah, I watched the sign off video too, which was obviously very constructed.
And for anyone not familiar with the T50, that is Gordon Murray's newest project. That's like basically another clean slate road car, similar to the F1, but he wanted it to be better than the F1 in every metric.
And if anybody doesn't know who Gordon Murray is or why he's significant, he was the engineer behind the McLaren F1.
Sorry. So he was the engineer
among other accolades, but I think that's what most people can relate to, is knowing that car.
Yeah, that one, and then he was pretty notorious in Formula One for making like the fan car, and because the fan car, I want to say it was either the fan car or that car with a CVT transmission that like they did a qualifying lap and it was 32 seconds ahead of everyone else.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
That number sticks out in my head. It was either a CVT transmission that was tested, or it was the Gordon Murray fan car, but it was banned, rightfully so, after that race.
The fan car was like an insane amount faster than the rest of the competition, and that was never used in a race because of how fast it was.
Gotcha. That's probably what I'm thinking of. But yeah, no. So Gordon Murray signed off of that. Also, the new M2 dropped. Well, not dropped. The embargo lifted on the M2.
The car dropped like three months ago or something like that.
Right. So we finally get to see and consume more content divulging how it drives and how it looks. What do you make of how it looks? Because we can't talk about how it drives.
But yeah, I have no idea how it drives. From what I've seen in the reviews, it's much more mature than the last M2, and it's probably much faster. And has that legendary S58 that's in the M4 and the M3. And which is funny because people didn't like that it was more mature than the previous M2. But again, I can't talk much about that. What I can tell you is how aesthetically it looks to me, and I'm not the most I'm not a design engineer or an art major or anything, but there are some funny decisions that were made in regards to marrying the front end of the car and the whole rest of the car, because it looks like two different cars were. It just looks like two different cars were just smashed together. The shapes just don't work. And I'm not a big fan. I mean, you're a boxy car guy, but this is a whole different level of using squares in design language. The vents up front, the vents at the bottom of the front bumper are very GT3 RS-ish, which works on the Porsche, but it doesn't work here. I don't know why visually it doesn't.
Because there's no other box on the car. Like there is
other than the grill. It goes
yeah.
To one box on each side, a box in the middle, and then and then the snout is two boxes that have little accent lines. Yeah. The headlights are fine.
They're better than the M240i.
I do like. I don't want to talk about the M240i. I think that is just straight up the ugly car. There's no like scientific design reason I can point out to that being an ugly car. It just is not visually appealing at all. The regular 2 series and the M240i, and then the Grand Coupe, which looks like a different model. It looks like it was supposed to be an SUV that was like someone made a chibi version of. But back on the M2, just like the M3 and the M4, the rest of the car is sexy as hell. It is the body lines are great. The rear end is pretty good. It's not my favorite rear end in the world, but it's a good looking ass. And the wheels that they chose that I've seen for, I don't know how many wheel options there are, but the ones that I've seen in the reviews and stuff, they look freaking fantastic. And the fitment as well is so good. It might be one of my favorite factory fitments that I've ever seen. And then you get to the front fender and it all falls apart. You get a little bit of continuing that body line, and then suddenly you have these valences coming in, and you got these big boxes, and you have this trapezoidal snout, and you have these headlights that work with, I guess they work with the front end, and it kind of marries the front end and the fender and going into the rest of the car, but it's such a stark difference. I don't know if it would look good on a car that used the same shapes or used the same kind of design language, but it doesn't work on this car. It almost looks too big. It almost looks like a snowplow up front.
Yeah, well, that's kind of the thing, is that there is one thing I will credit this car with having, is that it is still a small car. And like, you know, like you said, my favorite cars are like 2-box and 3-box, you know, boxes, like Datsun 510, Hakkosuka GTR, obviously E30. And so the fact that the M2 still maintains that really nice side profile is fantastic. But then I want to say it's 4 inches longer than the previous gen. And yeah, when you look at the side profile, it's like all of that extra length comes from the front bumper and the back bumper. Like it's just like a protuberance out on each side. And so it's like, I don't know. Maybe we're just in a really transigent time for BMW's design language and their identity. You know, like, I wonder what we would be saying right now if we were at the precipice of the Bangle era of BMW. That was a comment on our last episode. Is like after the E46 chassis, Bankel took over, and there was a lot of stuff that design languages that were pretty controversial at the time. So I wonder if it's something to do with that. But
no, I still think the E92 is one of the best looking BMWs.
It is. I agree.
Although I know people, some people disagree, but I love the E92.
So for context for the viewer, actually, if picture an E92 M3. Now in M2, the new body style M2, you can fit an E92 inside of an M2. That's the current size of the M2.
I didn't know that, actually. Mm-hmm. That wasn't just for the viewer, that was for me too. I didn't know that that's how big.
Yeah.
Cars have gotten big though. And the M2, which is supposed to be like the little brother, like the spunky little brother of the M3 and the M4, really the M4 if you were talking two doors. It weighs the same.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be a spunky little rear wheel drive car and it weighs the same. And of course, that's not just wasted weight. It all goes into making the car better, I suppose. But in the pursuit of making a car better, is it worth making it less tossable and assy and fun?
I think that's a really reasonable question, especially for something like an M2, where the philosophy of it is it being, the smaller version of an M4 or an M3,
Just yeah, so you're not trying to break records, and you're not trying to fight, Mercedes and Audi with the M2. Mercedes doesn't even have a real M2 competitor. And Audi, I don't know, if you want to say the TT, you could throw that in there. But this is a car that people buy to have fun. I saw an F87 M2 today, actually, just in the parking lot. And that's such a good looking car. The proportions are perfect. They're perfect. It's kind of cute. It's really sexy. The size is perfect. It's my ideal car shape. Yeah. Long nose, short booty, rear wheel drive. That's exactly what I want in a car. And the front end is so perfect because it's kind of a it's just kind of a smaller version. It's a smaller version of the M4 of the period, the F82. Because the way those vents go, they have all these angles in there, and it's super cool. Maybe with a little more mascara, because the headlights are a little like more cat-like. They're such cool looking cars, man. I've wanted one for a long, long time. I just don't know which car I would replace. But the M2, the new M2 just isn't that anymore. It doesn't have those that cat-like front end. It doesn't have that, it almost is like a regular three box coupe instead of that long nose short booty kind of thing. And that extra length in the back, the protrusions from the bumper, I think are a regulatory thing. As you said, Mercedes gets around that here in the United States, by just adding these fucking bumpers, like that aren't there in the European version behind, like that surround the license plate. And that's just how they do it. I mean, I guess that gets the job done, and I think BMW kind of wanted to incorporate it into the design so they wouldn't have to stick shit on whenever they go into different markets with different.
That's good context. I hadn't thought about that.
Yeah, I don't know if that's it for sure, but that's what I'm guessing, because it does. There, I can't think of another reason why you would ruin. Not ruin, because it still looks good, but you would add these all this unnecessary bulk.
Right.
I guess. Unless you were trying to make it work with the front end, but it doesn't.
Well, usually when you see car companies add bulk to the digital design, it's because they're trying to make it look muscly and brawny and aggressive. And that's certain, angry cars, right? But like
like angry car, look at your Camaro, it's pissed off.
What? Not me. But I was actually going to bring up the Camaro, because the Camaro is actually 80 pounds. My Camaro is 80 pounds lighter than the new M2, and it's 12 pounds heavier than the new, Nissan Z. And it's, I mean, so it's the idea of I don't mind that the M2 is actually that heavy anymore, because I drive my car and it feels big. It's too big. I don't like how big the car is. It is physically massive car, and it doesn't help that you can't see out of a Camaro.
Yeah, that's not a meme. That's a real thing.
Right. But I will say I am happy about the M2 still not being the size of an M4, despite the fact that it is still growing obese nonetheless. And so I like, if my car weighed the exact same that it does right now, but it was just smaller, then I would have so much less to say. I would find something else to nitpick about it, but I would have so much less to say about that.
You know, that's really interesting. Because the weight is like something very, I don't know, tangible to you.
Yeah. Well, that was kind of a thing for me for a while. I don't mean to cut you off, but like for a long time, I would take my car around a tight turn or something like that, and I would think like, man, this is just a big, heavy car. Until I started paying attention to the apex speeds, until I started learning how to push the car and where I was at the limit of things. And then I realized this car is going around turns way faster than anything else I've ever been in, you know? And now that's not saying much for my repertoire of the cars that I've been in, but you know, still the more that I found that it was not really the character of the car that was heavy, or so the car doesn't drive heavy. It just drives big. It's just and you know, I've got 14,000 miles. I hit 14,000 miles on it today. And so like I've gotten a pretty fair amount of seat time in it. And it's just the size of it that matters so much. Like of course a 2SS weighs 180 pounds heavier than that one. And I'm glad I don't have the 2SS because of that. But the fact remains, it still handles itself and it still puts the power down and it still does what it's made to do. And these cars can hit 1.11 lateral G's on a skid pad with all of that weight. And so it's heavy, be that as it may, but like everything, we're just in, just like what I said earlier of like, we're now in the hybrid era of sports cars. We're now in the era of sports cars where you can have clever suspension and clever chassis design that doesn't necessarily necessitate that in order to have a good car, it has to be light.
To a point. I mean, right now the hiding weight is like a big thing,
right?
The Mercedes and BMW both make very heavy cars now. That are the fastest cars in the world. So you have a lot of what looks like bloat when you look at the weight of a vehicle,
right?
That is managed very well by ridiculous suspension systems and extremely clever all-wheel drive with some level of torque vectoring, if you want to call it that, that pulls a car around a corner and hides all that weight. I mean, I can compare this to the EQE AMG that I drove down at Barber Motorsports Park, because that is a 5,500 pound car. It's a 5,500 pound electric car. So the EQE is Mercedes's electric version of the E-Class, and it's no secret that electric cars are heavy. The battery alone, it's a 12-cell battery. I think in the EQE it's a 10-cell. Hold on. I think it's a 10-cell in the EQE, and the And that's like a 1,200 pound battery, just the battery alone. But it's part of the structure of the car,
and it's low down.
Yeah, it's way low. That's the problem. That's not the problem. That's the thing. That whenever people talk about the weight of electric cars, it's all down at the bottom. But it's also in the EQE AMG that I drove, because we took it around some back roads as well. I mean, this thing was so pointy. It also had rear wheel steer. and it's I don't know if it was hiding its weight well, or since all the weight was at the bottom, like, you, center of gravity is a big, big thing, and the lower it is, the better. And the and whenever these car companies are making these electric cars right now in our climate, I mean, it's, the electric car shouldn't be a political thing, but yep. there are that's a whole other thing. But as a result of all these reasons that electric cars aren't being well received by, I would almost say, a majority of the, you know, car enthusiast realm, then they've got to make them as good as fucking possible. They need to come out swinging. They can't just they can't just kind of drag their feet and make cars that are proofs of concept. They need to make good cars now. And they are. The i4, really, really good. The iX, the EQS, and the EQE. That EQE is one of the most nimble cars I've ever driven. And I can compare that directly with the E63S. And you say some cars drive big and some cars are big and don't. The EQE and the E63S, I mean, those are big, big sedans. They're not small sedans. And they drive smaller than they are. I've said before that the E63S was felt more nimble than my 350Z that I've had many, many, many hours in. And one drive in E63S, I was like, this handles better than the Z. And it does, but the important thing was is that it felt more nimble. Like, a car can be faster, but not feel faster. Just because it's hiding everything, it's maybe a little bit more insulated, and it doesn't have that same raw feeling as a small analog sports car. And an E63S is far from analog. It's turbocharged and it's all-wheel drive, and it's got all these computers and sensors telling the engine and the transmission what to do at any given time. That is not an analog sports car, but God, it was fun. And for an all-wheel drive car with 600 horsepower, it was controllably assy, which I loved. And the EQE AMG, which is its direct electric equivalent now, it felt the same way. It felt, this 5,500 pound vehicle felt more nimble than my 350Z, and that is hysterical to me. I had a dumb look of disbelief on my face when I started throwing it around corners. That is so bizarre. And so the fact that a car company can hide 5,500 pounds, that's 2,500 pounds more than my 350Z. 2,500, that's almost another 350Z on top of the 350Z. You know, it may be a bad example since all the weight's at the bottom. There's a lot of things to consider and all that good stuff. But the E63S, the gas one, is just another example of that. Just weight can be hidden through really good suspension, really good all-wheel drive.
So, okay. We talked about hybrids. We talked about tournaments. The 350Zs and stuff like that. Now moving on to, I guess, the fun part of the episode. Well, not that wasn't fun, but, you know, the different part of the episode of...
Was that the icebreaker?
Oh. Yeah, I guess so.
That was, yeah, 37 minutes.
Oh, that's some thick ass ice.
Yeah, I know. We had to listen. We were hammering away the other.
So, what this video is supposed to be about is being a car enthusiast when your significant other is not into cars. So, I don't think that we have time to talk about what got us interested in cars or what our favorite project car memories are with each other. I think we'll have to do that for a different episode, which I think that'll be a fun episode on its own. So my first question for you now is, how did you meet Laurel? And when did cars first become a factor in your relationship with Laurel? And also, you know, before we get started, when have cars been a negative or positive impact with Laurel and or any other relationships that you've had.
So the peak of my car guy hooliganism was in college, which you know, wasn't that long ago for me, just a couple years ago. And I got out of a long-term relationship right before COVID. No, it was right after COVID started. So in 2020, right before graduating, I got out of a long-term relationship, and right at then I was embroiled in the car scene of some students who went to the University of Alabama, where I went. And so this is when the 350Z was my only car. So anybody meeting me, the car stuff was going to be like immediately part of the equation.
Right. Yeah.
So I was going on a couple of dates at the time, after a couple months after I got out of this relationship. And whenever I met Laurel, so I met Laurel on Tinder. And so I showed up for our first date, and I had to park kind of far away not because I was hiding my car from her, but because it was just downtown. It was hard to find a place to park. So we met up close to the bar we were going to go at. It was like a cocktail bar. It was super nice. For our first date, you know, we had a good time, whatever. My Z didn't have a front bumper at the time. So she knew I was a car guy, because that was like part of my Tinder bio. It's right. Its way into most of my conversation since we're getting to know each other. And so she didn't know this at the time, but this car was screwed up. You know, this car was seeing back road runs like 3-4 times a week. It was getting worked on every weekend for either to add something or fix something. And I worked at AutoZone at the time, so I just kind of perpetually smelled like motor oil and grease and stuff. And I had like black shit under my fingernails, and you know. So that there's no hiding that. When did cars become part of the equation, or whatever the actual question was? When it comes to Laurel, my now fiance, is the answer is immediately, because I mean, it's just what it is, what it is. So our second date, I made her dinner, and she came to my apartment and everything, and I have car parts like in places.
Was that the date that I made you late for because we got stuck and we had to walk like an hour just to get cell phones? We got stuck doing my car thing. Remember that?
No, it wasn't. It wasn't. It wasn't. We were pretty established at that point. the second date was, I don't remember what I was doing that day, but the second date was pretty, that was fine. I like made a steak and stuff, and that was fine. And Nessie still didn't have my 350Z didn't have a bumper. So as time goes on, the funny thing is that after our first date, which I didn't even realize that she liked me that much after our first date, because she's got a very straight kind of attitude. And so I, she doesn't really show that much emotion in general. And so I was just like, oh, this girl doesn't really like me. She's like, she's like super lukewarm on this whole thing. Mm. And then at the end of that date, she was like, so, let's do this again sometime. I'm like, oh, all right. And so I just continued talking to her because that weekend I was leaving for my birthday, where I hit a rabbit and punctured my radiator, and then my car was stranded at a marathon in freaking Andalusia, Alabama, or something like that, on the way down to Destin. And then there had to be like two different crews of people coming from two different places in Alabama coming down for my birthday, who had to team up and figure out how to get a radiator to me so that I could replace the radiator. Yep, in the parking lot of that marathon. And that's a whole nother story, because I replaced the radiator, realized that the rabbit that I hit had completely, because I didn't have a front bumper, had completely shattered my radiator fan assembly, which I didn't even realize in the dark. All I thought I needed was a radiator.
Right.
And so we got going, and I thought it was going to work. I thought it would be fine because, like, it was still kind of there. So I thought if I placed it still plugged in, the fans were still there. I figured if I got it into place, if I zip tied everything into place, the fans would still work. And so it was another 2 hour drive to Destin from that spot.
Right.
For temporal context, I was stranded at night. And so the guy I was convoying with, Liam, I just got in his car and we went the rest of the way to Destin, slept, woke up. I got with everybody who was coming that day. And I'm like, hey, I've got to drive like 2 hours back to this marathon in Andalusia. Can you guys meet me here with the radiator? And they came in clutch, and they did. And so we did that surgery in the parking lot, and then we set off. And like literally an hour goes by without a hitch because you don't come to a stop. It's all highway almost. And then we get to Destin traffic, which is almost the worst that I had ever seen it, with no radiator fan assembly. And so we basically come to a stop. I have another guy in my car. We come to a stop, and it was basically, I think he was driving. We come to a stop, turn off the car, crawl forward with the traffic, turn off the car, traffic goes forward, turn on the car, move forward. Because at this point we realize whenever we sit still, the temperature just skyrockets. So that was just that for like 30 fucking minutes. Oh, it was so stressful. And so I'd say none of this to Laurel, who I'm texting a girl that I am interested in, and I think she's interested in me. I'm like, oh, birthday's going great. You know, we've had a drama-free morning when I have spent the last 4 hours just trying to get this car home. Or get this car to my parents' house in Destin, Florida.
You said it was no problemo, and in fact, it was all problemo.
It was all problemo, man. And so... Mami, yo te veo ahí con tus amigas y todas tan bien ricas. We eventually got it there, and then we have the time of our lives, of course, and then I have to go back to AutoZone and get a radiator fan assembly and replace that, which that was fine. Car was great afterwards, except for the fact that I didn't realize when I removed the radiator, I completely drained the transmission fluid or the transmission cooler. And so there was a little bit of transmission fluid left, which was fine for the drive back up to Tuscaloosa, where I had come from, because, you know, how many gear changes is the car making in it's an automatic, by the way. How many gear changes is the car making, you know, between Destin and Tuscaloosa. So I didn't notice any issue. I didn't notice any missing fluid or anything. Right. I think I thought it was like power steering cooling, and I'm like, oh, this is fine. Like, it didn't lose that much when it in fact lost quite a bit, because the very next day after my birthday weekend, I woke up and my car is doing rough shifting, and it's having issues. So that was a whole nother chapter of that. And through all of this, I'm like, I cannot let the girl know that this is
my right. Life. Yeah.
Because I'm dumb and I don't double check things, and the car is ultra high mileage. So it's just this and that. And, God, there's a lot of like memories surrounding me trying to start this budding relationship with my now future wife, that revolves around my car being a headache in my life. And it's not a headache because the car is a headache, because the car itself was very reliable. It's just that when I hit things or I did something wrong during a repair, which was many times, then that would just kind of cascade into many hijinks. So the fact that I got through that at all without her thinking that I was insane is impressive. Yeah. But yeah, so I mean, I guess long story short, I met Laurel on Tinder, and I had gone on a couple dates, and then she's the only one I went on a second date with, and I think it may have been our third date where I was like, so there's this route in Tuscaloosa we called the Watermelon Run. They don't do it so much anymore, but it was just this back road run that we would just fly around like the back roads of what's called Watermelon Road. It was it kind of surrounded the center of Lake Tuscaloosa and Lake Nickel, and they were just some really, really fun, like low speed and high speed turns. It had everything. In Alabama, in central Alabama, you don't really have much, so you gotta get what you can get. And so, and that's the route we had done whenever we just wanted to do a cruise or just, you know, have a little bit of spirited driving. And so I said, hey, me and my friends are doing a watermelon run tonight. It was our third date. I think we had gone to a Mexican restaurant before. And I was like, and she was like, yeah, we can do that. And so I remember we got together in like the Whataburger parking lot with my friends, and my car was loud. My friends' cars are louder. And then this one guy pulls up in his stupid loud ultra high horsepower GTR. And we thought he was going to do the run with us, but that was not what that car was for. That car was for winning money in a straight line. And I'll never forget. This was Laurel being thrust into
no warning whatsoever
into my car enthusiast life.
Right.
I remember me and my friend in her Camaro lined up at the red light, like right outside the Whataburger. Light turned green. We set off, and it's actually a pretty good race. And then we're at about 120 miles an hour, and this guy in the GTR shoots past us like we're standing still. Like, he obviously started like way after we started.
Right, yeah.
And he just freaking rockets past us. And I physically and verbally react. Uh-huh. And this, again, this is Laurel's first introduction to car culture in general, because she's basically not a car person.
Right.
And we hadn't even gotten to the main event of the night.
Mm-hmm.
So she was a trooper. It was like a 20-minute drive to Watermelon Road. We get out there, and I was just like, "You trust me, right?" Because we don't know each other that well. She was right. She just goes, "Yep." And so so we did it. I was not that careful. Everything went fine. I overheated my brakes as usual.
Right. And everything, you do that every single time.
Every single time. we stopped at our usual place, and everybody was super stoked, and she seemed like she had a good time. And she tells me now that was the night that she knew that she was in love with me. Isn't that
sweet? Awesome? Yeah.
That's sweet.
That's so good. So we're going to have to do an entire episode on how me and you met and how me and you got into cars and stuff too, because like there are
at the time Isaac's name was Laurel and
no, that's not yeah, I was like timing of that. That's weird. So but I was just thinking earlier what you were saying about like I remember you getting the 350Z, and I remember like all of like the many hours we spent in here working on it and stuff like that. And yeah, we got to do like a whole episode on how we got into cars and like, I don't know. But anyways, yeah, similar, you handled your car life seemingly a lot better than I did with Eric. So
you were much younger and much more of a miscreant than me at the end of my college career.
Well, okay. So I met
What are you trying to say?
I met Erica in school, and
exactly.
And so we were friends for years. My mom and her mom worked together since before we were born. Me and her were born like 13 hours apart, like down the hall from each other. And so it was kind of almost engineered by our parents that we would spend a lot of time around each other. And we, you know, we became best friends, but she rejected me for years. I'm talking literal. So finally I just left it alone. I was like, we're just going to be friends. That same day I decided that, she kissed me and now we're getting married. So, okay. As far as cars, when cars first entered kind of like the group consciousness of something that I was interested in, it's kind of always been a thing. You know, both of my parents, like my dad always had Supras and Fox bodies. My mom also had a Fox body. My uncle has had like 6 Mustang. My aunt has had an SS396. She's had one or two Datsun 260 and 240Zs. My granddad had a pretty rare Fairlane Ranchero with a 429 big block in it. So I've been pretty much inundated with car. I was screwed from the jump is what I'm saying as far as that. So but the thing is she was kind of always around it in the sense of me just doing basic maintenance and repairs to the stuff that I was trying to drive to work and back. So it wasn't until I became more financially stable and that she really knew that I was much of a driver or a car enthusiast as I was just someone who was, you know, who was sympathetic mechanically, you know? And so, but what I drove for years before I could afford to get anything else was my family's 1988 GMC C2500 work truck. And that truck, the odometer broke 12 years ago. It broke at 380,000 miles. It has been daily driven since then for the last 11 years. And so in that car, it was also, or that truck, it was a fire truck before it was the family truck. And then,
I didn't know that.
Yep. And then after that, it was a graveyard truck. So it lifted like tombstones and granite rocks and stuff like that.
I didn't know a graveyard truck was a thing.
Yeah.
Tombstones just grew there.
Right, it's had a hard life, man. So,
hi guys.
Before me and Erica dated, that truck was the end point of every relationship that I had had.
What does that mean? Oh, like it scared them off.
Yeah, there was one date that I went on. Everything was going fantastic. We hit it off until she saw the truck, and then I shit you not, she took her jacket off, put it on the seat, and sat on the jacket when we got into the truck. She asked me to take her home early. I'll never forget that. So, but here's the thing. Me and Erica graduate. We start our relationship. Of course, the truck isn't running. She sees it for the first time a week and a half after the fact. She sees that it has this giant crane on the back of it. And I was nervous because that truck had, again, like I said, had been the endpoint of my relationship.
Yeah, pictures of this truck with the crane.
Yeah, I have plenty of pictures.
Okay, I got to see that. You got to show me that because that is just, maybe it's right here.
No.
Erica sees the truck. First thing she does is, I have an Inu that'll fit right on that crane. And that was like, I was like, yep, that's, she's a
all keeper. Right.
Yep. Yeah.
I can't keep looking. It's going to take forever for me to find someone who would make that comment looking at that crane again.
Exactly. So when I was writing the notes for this episode, since that was 6 years ago, I have, and just in the past 2.5 years, I've had 11 cars. And over the course of the past 6 years, I think I've had 14. And I asked Erica about what were some hallmarks of times that we've either gotten stranded. And I said, if we've ever gotten stranded, what are the times that you remember? She recounted with pictures 7 times that we got stranded in my cars. 7 times that my cars have broken down. Okay. I actually wrote it down. I said the first 2 times were in that old truck. The first time I actually remember this, the AC compressor, the AC never worked in the truck, but I didn't take the AC compressor off because it's just another pulley at that point.
7 times.
So the first time the AC compressor bearing like seized. So of course the serpentine belt comes off. We got to fix that. So door, get another pulley, put it on at the gas station across the street from where I now live. And the second time was also in the truck. There was nothing mechanically wrong with the truck, but I got it stuck in the mud while we were on a date on Valentine's Day. So that was the second time. Let's see. The next 3 times were all in a white E30. And then the 2 times after that were both in blue. But she's stuck with it. She stuck with me through it all.
Seriously, props to her. I don't even know if I would do that.
I know. Yeah, no. Well, what's funny, she got a 2019 Blazer, and after she got that Blazer, I was like, you know, babe, I don't know if I could date anybody with a car any older than the 2019. And she was just like, oh, shut up. But one of the cool things about it was that, like, through this is she's gotten a little bit of an interest in cars too. And so that influenced the car that she wanted, which was a Blazer, which is just a crossover, but it's a crossover that is better than it has a right to be. And she chose it because it drove better than the other cars. And so one of my favorite memories, also with Blue, I've had a lot of good memories with Blue, especially with you guys and stuff. But one of them was I was able to teach Eric how to drive manual in Blue, as well as Gio. And Erica, like, I think she stalled it one time, and then the rest of the time, every other time, she nailed it. And so it's just cool. It's neat that, you know, I've had almost all through my own doing. Let me be clear that after my first struggles in my first truck, pretty much everything after that was self-inflicted due to me being interested in cars. And so Erica's really stuck with it through it all. And I think, but you know, in general, we just have a very healthy relationship. We have a relationship where she is way more into sports than I am. And I work to appreciate her and appreciate the things that she's into. And vice versa, I'm way more into cars than she is. And she works to be understanding and be appreciative of the things that I'm appreciative for. And I see that with you and Laurel too. You know, like Laurel has been with it since day one.
Laurel goes through a lot and puts a great deal of effort into, you know, indulging and being involved in my vehicular escapades. The Z is currently on 4 jack stands in our garage right now, and I'll spend hours at a time on it.
Yeah.
And she, at the very least, she will spend her time, she will sit down with her laptop on a chair. And if not that, she'll be like, do you need me to hold anything? Do you need me to hold something up or just kind of keep something in place? She genuinely is a, you know, she's a great part of my passions and my interests and stuff, you know, and I appreciate that about her. And I think it really helps that she was introduced in a very sudden kind of way into that kind of lifestyle when we started dating.
Yeah, because that's you. And that's part of who you are.
Exactly. And it's been a massive part of our relationship. The Z was a huge part of our relationship whenever it was my only car. You know, it's what got us around. It's what I was, it's what took up a great deal of my time. It's what I'm known for to a lot of people. And as a result, it's what she's known for to a lot of people. If that makes sense. That's like, that car is almost as much of part of her identity as it is mine for the past 3 years, you know?
Yeah.
So like it or not, I mean, she's a car girl. I tell her all the time.
Yeah.
You know, and Erica is the same way, you know, just by proxy. This isn't a casual interest. It's very much a lifestyle, and less so now. I mean, I say less so now, but my job is cars. But but it's less so now, like part of my lifestyle to do hooligan dumb car shit than it was back then. But it's still, you know, it's still part of who I am. As it's not very much part of who she is now, but it's definitely part of our history.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, another thing I was thinking about is like
to this day,
Erica and Laurel are still coming in clutch. I mean, hell, we are using Laurel's Zoom account right now to make this podcast. We are, okay, this is
we would have had to cut it short, you know, 18 minutes ago.
This concept of like being a car person when your significant other is not, this is Laurel's idea that we're doing.
Oh yeah, the idea, the concept of this episode was in fact her idea.
Yeah, I'm editing
this video. I didn't even ask her for any ideas.
No, she just came out with just like a fire idea. We're editing the videos on the computer that Erica got me. we're shooting the videos this weekend. Due to Erica coming up with me and helping us shoot the video because she wants to see it happen. And so
exactly.
It's just, you know, we're just lucky, man. I mean, as much as we like cars and as much of a huge part of that of our life that stuff is, we are incredibly fortunate to have the relationships that we have, not only in romantic relationships, but like if me and you hadn't met, I think both of our trajectories would be different, and maybe I know I would be less successful than I am right now if me and you weren't as close as we are.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I don't believe that.
Well, so, but like the, you know, but to get back on topic with Laurel and Erica, like, you know, the fact that we found partners that we have tricked them into marrying us and they have enriched our lives and, you know, enriched our lives in a way that allows us to continue to do and cultivate what we like. So
I just completely agree. I would not be, I mean, I literally wouldn't be where I am now without my future wife.
Right. You know, yeah.
This,
I also,
a great deal of my life is because of her. My current life is because of her.
Yeah. No, I agree. Same with Erica. And
this isn't a car podcast anymore. This is a girl podcast.
I know. Yeah. Do girls have hobbies? No, but no, it's like, it's, you know, I think the answer to the question, like if there even is a question, is, you know, to wrap it up with, is like, you know, if you're a car guy and your significant other is not a car person, if you got a good relationship, that does not matter. That doesn't come, that only, your life only improves, you know, with when you have the right partner.
Oh, well, I mean, she keeps me responsible as well. That is a huge part of our relationship, is her keeping me in check in a very responsible manner. I think by nature, most car guys are not very responsible. just the nature that you need to, you know, have the mental bandwidth to not do what, essentially not do the right thing, morally, legally, financially, you know, there's just a lot of downturn decisions that you have to make on the way of becoming peak in car enthusiast. You know what I mean?
I had 4 cars at once at one point last year in a apartment that only allowed 2 car space. I wish I could say I've improved since then, but Erica stopped me this week from selling the truck so I could buy GoFast parts for the car. Last week, she stopped me from buying a Buick Roadmaster with 44,000 miles on it. Because you like the Buick Roadmaster estate wagon with the wood paneling on it. It had 44,000 miles on it. And I was like,
come on, man.
You gotta buy this car. And Erica was like, you do not gotta buy that car. But yeah, I think that's a good place to end it, man. Yeah, being a car guy when your significant other is not is no different from being into sports or being into anything else. But when you have the right partner, and when you have the right partner, they're going to enrich your life and potentially keep you out of bankruptcy, like you said. So
I can only agree with your summarization there. Now, what I really want to hear is about a car girl whose significant other is not a car guy. Because I feel like the dynamic would be different, but
that's true. Yeah. Who knows? Maybe we'll have a guest one day. Maybe.
Too bad there's no car girls. So.
I know. Yeah. Well, you know, they don't have hobbies. So. Woo.